Hi folks, it's Lisa with Bulldog Tours. I'm going to give it a couple seconds for some folks to join us. Today we've got a lot of stuff to talk about. It's a beautiful day, really warm out here. My face is really red, it's kind of hot. We're at the Old Navy Yard in North Charleston. So we're going to give it just a few seconds for some folks to join us. Ladies, thanks for joining me. Beautiful day out here. So folks, we're at the Old Navy Yard in North Charleston. We are at the Keeper's House. I'm going to turn this around so y'all can see what I'm seeing. We've got the last bit of azaleas here and a few other things for you to see. Now why can't I? Oh, here we go. Hi, Hartsville. Thanks for joining us. And Somerville. I'm going to turn this around, y'all. There we go. So what you're seeing is the grounds of the Keeper of the Parks house. You're also going to see the last of the azaleas here. Still pretty, but not nearly as many as there usually would be. Across the street, they're doing a lot of construction. We're gonna pretend like they're not there. So y'all, this was the Keeper of the Park's home, Shakora Park, and it was built in 1896. It's 5,000 square feet or so. It was finished restoration in January of 2018. Downstairs is now used as event space, and upstairs they have a bed and breakfast going on, which I'm curious to find out more about. But let's go back a little bit further. Well, I'm showing you these big live oak trees and Spanish moss. This whole area in the 1800s would have been rice plantations. Several of the names you might be familiar with, Long Point, Oak Grove, Retreat, the Marshlands. And by the 1890s, as you can imagine, the rice commerce was not what it had been. The city fathers decided that they wanted to make a park, a regional park, that Lowcountry folks could come out and enjoy and spend some time with their family. And in order to make sure they had the best of the best, John Laverne, you're exactly right, they hired the Olmsted brothers, the firm out of Massachusetts, to do the landscaping and design. Now, Olmsted may be familiar to you because their father was the man who designed Central Park in New York City. And before they came here, the Olmsteds designed and landscaped the gardens at Biltmore House up in Asheville, North Carolina. Many of y'all are probably familiar with that. Now, when they got here, they didn't disappoint. There were saltwater lagoons with bridges. There were nature trails. They had a nursery for the plants. They had a huge pavilion for entertainment. They had a wharf. They also had a golf links out here. And the city extended the trolley line to come out here so folks could come out for the day to picnic with their family or on a summer evening for maybe dances at that pavilion. Now everything was going well. People enjoyed it, and that went on for a couple of years. But after the Spanish-American War, the United States government realized that they really needed more bases and Navy Yards on the East Coast. And as you can imagine, hey Clara, as you can imagine, there was quite a scramble to see who was going to get that contract. Well, we had some folks working for us, including the governor, including the mayor of the time, Mayor Smith, and we also had Pitchfork Ben Tillman. Well, his name was Ben Tillman, but locally they called him Pitchfork Ben Tillman, and we may get into that story on another day. But he was well known, or he is well known, for having been instrumental in the founding of Clemson University. He was also high profile during the Prohibition era, or at least the illegal liquor running era of Charleston. Well, he was also the head of the Naval Affairs Committee, and so he was very powerful. And He had quite a bit of pull and ensured that the Navy Yard was brought to Charleston. Making it easier for him was the fact that through the years, the Army Corps of Engineers had worked hard on the channel here in Charleston, and by the turn of the century, it was twice as deep as it had been just two decades earlier. Well, that made it a pretty simple decision for the government, coupled with the fact that the city offered up Shakora Park to be used as the Navy Yard. Well, by 1900, the contract was awarded, and building began about 1902. In 1901, they had a big luncheon here at this house with Captain Longnecker. He was the man who was going to be the commandant of the Navy Yard. And he brought $110,000, and with that money, they were able to buy 2,250 acres of land for the Navy Yard. Well, after the big luncheon, and Senator Tillman was here, the mayor was here, many of the prominent city fathers were here for that as well. After that, building began around 1902. Now, I will tell you that when they bought this property, there were four buildings still on site, and one was what we call the Dead House. Another was Turnbull Mansion. Another was Marshland Plantation House. And the other was this Keeper's Cottage. Well, we call it the Dead House, but we think it was built in the early 1700s, pre-revolutionary, and it was probably built as a powder magazine. Although possibly in later years they did use it as a dead house. Now, a dead house is where they would have kept bodies, kind of a cool house until the funeral happened. So it may have been used as a dead house. Right now, in North Charleston, they're doing some research and study, trying to find out how old that building actually is. They took a city seal that was over the doorway of the dead house, and they're running some tests on it currently. The Turnbull Mansion was destroyed by fire shortly after the building of the yard started. The Keeper's Cottage is still here today, and Marshland Plantation House was used for many years, well into the 50s and 60s, before being floated down the Cooper River over to Fort Johnson on James Island, and that's where it sits today. It's the South Carolina Wildlife Marine and Resources Department, and it's really beautiful. It sits right on the water. I went to a few oyster roasts there in my time. Well, by 1902, they'd started working on the dry dock, and that took about 5 years to complete. 1909, they had five shop offices built. They also had the powerhouse built, and the dry dock was completed. Now, they had started repairing ships long before all of the facilities were built, and by that time, there were 300 civilians and countless naval officers working here at the Navy Yard. By 1912, they started the machinist school, and there were, I guess, about 150 to 200 men in that original class. In 1913, the very first vessels to be built were built, and they were two paddle wheel steamers. One was called the PD, the other was called the Waterree, and they were used by the Army Corps of Engineers to remove debris and obstructions on the inland waterways. By 1914, the Naval Clothing Factory was put into place. They ended up hiring over 1,000 local women as seamstresses there, sewing uniforms for the U.S. Navy. 1917 found the U.S. entering World War I. Now, that's when things really kicked into gear here. By that time, there were 1,700 people working here, including a man named John K. McKenzie. Now, y'all, he worked over in the boiler shop, and his experience stretched all the way back to the Confederate Navy. He actually had worked on the H.L. Hunley. And those of you may be familiar with the Hunley, that was the first successful combat submarine. Now, also in 1917, in June of 1917, the keel for the first gunship to be built here was laid, and it was for the gunship Asheville. That was the very first major U.S. warship to be built here in more than a century. Now, a year later, when that vessel was launched, they christened it not with a bottle of champagne, but with a bottle of pure mountain stream water from the mountains of Asheville, North Carolina. Have quite a tie there. That's where a lot of my family's from Western North Carolina. So love to hear that. Now, also in 1917, they moved the naval training camps here, or they opened a naval training camp here, more accurately. And during the war, as many as 5,000 sailors went through basic training here at that naval training camp. In August of 1918, a 23-year-old young man from New Rochelle, New York, by all accounts a scrawny man, was not going to make much of a soldier, but he'd already made quite a name for himself as an artist. He drew cartoons and illustrations for both the Evening Post as well as Life. When he came here, they quickly put him to work at the newspaper that was being put out here at the Navy Yard. It was called Afloat and Ashore. And he illustrated it, he did the layouts, and he also drew cartoons for it. And they allowed him to continue his work with Life and the Evening Post as long as all of his drawings or work with them had something to do with the Navy. And during the war, that was pretty easy to do. You might be familiar with that man. His name was Norman Rockwell. Now, y'all, we've talked a lot. I've told you a lot of details. And I'll tell you that by World War II, this Navy Yard was the largest employer the state would have ever seen. And still, to this day, was the largest employer the state's ever known. There were 26,000 people employed here. New vessels were being made every week. They were launching as many as 4 a day from here at the Charleston Navy Yard. There's so much more to tell. The Navy Yard was here from 1900 to 1996 and was very instrumental in World War II and into the modern era. We've got so much to talk about in such little time. I would ask that you join me tomorrow at 2:00 and we'll finish the story. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please put them in the comments and I'll try to answer them as best I can. It's a lovely day out here. You're looking at some live oak trees with Spanish moss hanging in them. Y'all, please take care of each other. Stay safe, and we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks so much. I guess I should say goodbye to your face. Have a great day, y'all. Take care of each other. God bless.